generosity and your prayers to make this possible. And we are going to see God do amazing things as these church planters, they go in and plant churches that will plant churches. And we're only seeing the tip of the iceberg of what God's going to do. And now we're here in Uganda, and we just finished an all-day training with John Wandera's pastors. These were 46 pastors that have planted churches out of John Wandera's church. And so now we have a message from Pastor John Wandera to all of you at Canyon View. God bless you guys, and we can't wait to come back and share more of what God has done.
Hi, Canyon View Vineyard Church. This is your brother, John Wandera from Uganda. It has been such a wonderful time having Pastor Kirk visiting with us in Uganda. We thought that maybe I'll make him taller like me, but I couldn't because of the sushi that he ate while he was still young. He has been a blessing to us. He has been training the pastors. This is my wife, Jessica. Say hi.
Hi.
Pastor Kirk has been training the pastors. Pastors, have you been blessed by Pastor Kirk?
Yes.
Would you love Pastor Kirk to come back again?
Yes.
What about Pastor Nate? Would you like Pastor Nate to come back, pastors?
Yes.
We love you very much, Canyon View. Thank you very much for being a blessing to us. And we would love you one day to come and celebrate with us as you are moving from the current building where we are meeting from to our new building, which we are soon inaugurating officially. Thank you very, very much. I would love to invite all of you to come and visit us in Uganda, Africa one day. Thank you. Thank you very much. God bless you big. And we all say, bye, man.
Yes.
Yes.
I've always been an insecure person, and I really didn't know who I was. And this whiteout has just showed me who I was, and I found my identity. It just opened my eyes. I don't know how to explain it, but I was blind before. I've been coming here, and you know, I think it's great, but this year is different. And I guess it just changed me. I'm a different person now. I'm more outgoing. I can talk to people, and it's just, I feel like I'm on fire for him right now.
So people was just like a big fear that I had.
Yeah.
But it was just an amazing experience to meet new people and to get out of my comfort zone. If it's your first time, just come on out. I mean, it's a great experience. It changes your life.
How's everybody doing? Good. My name's DJ, and I am, my wife and I are going to be church planting in a couple months. And so until then, we are training, and that's why we're here with you today. Let's just pray, shall we? Just come, Holy Spirit. We just welcome you. God, we just welcome you here. Just come. Lord, as we stand before you today, digging into another section of Genesis, God, we come with our lives and all kinds of stuff and messes going on in our lives. And I pray that what you have to say to do today would connect to our heart, and that would connect to what we need to hear from you. And God, for all of us, let us see the big picture today of who you are. Or let us just, it's almost like step back or jump in an airplane and see the 50,000 foot view. God, let us take a step away from, you know, sort of the daily grind and look at the big picture of what you're doing, God. And in that, God, may we just learn to trust you even more. Pray this all in your name. Amen. All right, well, it's good to be here. I want to talk a little bit about Whiteout. Whiteout is an event that we put on every year for teenagers, and it's a Vineyard event. And this year I had the pleasure of going my last time. It was my 8th year, and I got to be the speaker, which was awesome. I just absolutely enjoyed it. There were so many good things that happened at Whiteout. Just getting all these teenagers away from the normal daily routine of life into the mountains where we could sort of clearly focus on God. And before I go any further, can I just put a quick plug for our youth ministry here? Derek Trenda is leading it, and we have an incredible team of leaders that are now leading, you know, the middle school and the high school ministries over there. If you've never sent your kids, or if you're a kid and you've never been over there, you've got to get connected to these guys. I think this is one of the best things that we do at the church. And I really believe that Derek and his team, where they're taking the youth ministry, is exactly where it needs to go. At Whiteout this year, I just felt like we saw this supernatural outpouring of God. And when God shows up and does stuff, I mean, it's just amazing to sit there and watch. And I don't know if you've ever been to a Camp High type of experience in your life where you just felt very, I don't know how to say, like emotional in your response to God. And, you know, sometimes we question, are those experiences valid, right? Because we don't want to be sort of tricked emotionally into something. Well, I think they're incredible. I think they shape our lives. And I want to share a couple stories of why I think that. First, this year there was this girl, it was the second to last night, she came up to me. Her name's Emma, and she's a 7th grader. And she came up to me and said, DJ, I'm going to get saved tonight. And I was like, okay, so you're going to get saved? Like, you haven't? She's like, no, yeah, I haven't done it yet. I want to do it with my counselors and with everybody in my group, but I'm going to get saved tonight. And I was like, that's awesome. And she's like, I want to dance for the whole group. I'm a dancer. She's a 7th grader. She's like this tall. I'm standing 2 steps below her so I can look her in the eye. You know what I mean? And she says, I want to do a dance for everyone tomorrow, if I can, to show them what it feels like to be saved. And I'm like, really? Okay. So I talked to her leader. This is legit. Her and her brother are nationally recognized dance competitors. They live in Fort Collins. They're awesome kids, and this girl legitimately was making a decision to follow God for the first time. And so we let her the last session. We started the session with her coming up and doing a dance. And this was just a freestyle, like she turned on music and just started dancing. And I don't think there was a dry eye in the audience. I mean, it was just amazing watching this girl, like, and I don't know that I'm very artistic. Maybe some of you guys are, but I was artistic in that moment. Like, I got it. And it was just amazing to watch her, like, sort of dancing out her expression of what God had done in her life. And at the end, this little 13-year-old girl, the whole audience just standing ovation instantly. Just everybody cheering and praising God for what God had done in her life. And after that, I asked anybody for the first time, and I said, don't fake this. You don't need to pretend. We're at church here. We can be honest. But anybody for the first time that's given their life to Christ, while being here at camp, know your life's never going to be different. The old has gone, the new has come, right? If that's you, could you please stand up? And about 50 kids, for the first time, stood up saying that they had salvation in Christ. And then I said, you know, for anybody in here who has had such a significant life change that you just know your life is not going to be the same anymore, kind of like the kids that were sharing, both of those kids that we just heard share today, they're believers, but they had some things going on in their life, And God just met him in that. And so I said, you know, if you've experienced sort of a life-changing experience, you know you're not going to be the same going forward. Please stand up. And there's probably three-fourths or more of the audience that stood up. And that's why we do Whiteout, right? We do Whiteout and youth ministry because we believe that these students are now actively the impetus for life change in the valley, beyond the valley, and in our world. I mean, these kids are passionate, right? And it was so fun to be a part of that. When I look back at Whiteout moments, there's one that I'll never forget. Is Sheila Worth, are you still here? She may be out there. Sheila's our piano. Oh, there you are. Hey, I want to tell a story about somebody that you love very much. A couple years ago, we were at Whiteout, and the speaker, his name was Gary Best, was there. And Gary Best has been here. He's really into the prophetic gifts of the ministry, right? But he does it in a very, what he calls, naturally supernatural way. And so one of the sessions, right, there's 500 kids, and one of the sessions, he says, who needs to, like, hear something from God? You know, and 100 kids or so raise their hand. Me, you know? And so he grabs somebody from the audience, and he said, I just want you to ask God who he wants to work on. I want you to pick three kids. So he picked three kids. One of the kids was from Grand Junction. His name was Nate Scogan. And so Nate comes down along with these other two kids. And then again, Gary's like, okay, which one, you know, do we just feel like God wants to... Actually, he asked the crowd, which one do you feel like God has given you a word or something specifically for this person, right? And so he asked the crowd, everybody closed their eyes. And then when he sort of pointed at each person, we were supposed to raise our hands, right? And the majority of the room raised their hands about this kid, Nate. And so Nate stood up front. Nate's a great kid, just an absolute joy to be around. But we were not really sure where Nate was in his relationship with the Lord. And so we thought it was pretty crazy that he was the one up there that all these people were going to speak about. And so what Gary did is he had every single person that had raised their hand, probably 200 kids, come forward and share basically one or two or three words of what they felt like God was saying about Nate. And you can imagine, it was just like an overwhelming experience, right? Sheila, do you remember this? I mean, it was just one of those, like, you'll never forget it in your life kind of moments. And so they talked about Nate, and so each person would come up to Nate, and Nate was standing there, and they would say into the mic, Nate, I feel like you are. And then they would say this over and over and over, and, you know, Nate couldn't help but just, you know, just be overwhelmed by this presence of God. And it was amazing how almost, I mean, there was like three themes, and I don't remember them, but I just remember there was three themes that everybody almost said the same thing, right? Well, Nate got baptized that weekend. And his dad drove up from Carbondale. His dad lived in Carbondale, drove all the way up to Frontier Ranch, met us up there, and we baptized Nate. And Nate was never the same. He came back this joyful person. He probably brought more kids to youth group than maybe anybody else. And all these kids are kids that didn't know the Lord. And so Nate always had this posse of people around him that were like, are these guys supposed to be at church? And I'm just kidding. And anyway, in May that year, so 3 months later, Nate was in a motorcycle accident. And I got the call. I was in my bedroom, and Nate passed away instantly. And, you know, Nate's a great kid. And I remember when I heard that, I was just like, but God, all those things you spoke at camp, all that, all this life change. You know, Nate's such an incredible kid. Why would you take him away, you know? And that was a really hard hard funeral, wasn't it? Sheila loved him. Like, I mean, Nate was like one of her second sons. Her son Nate and Nate were best friends, and so Nate was always at their house. And anyway, when I looked back at, well, let me tell you this. A bunch of kids came to his funeral, and his favorite song was this song by Lincoln Brewster called Our God Reigns. And I'll never forget the pastor that knew him since Nate was young that was doing the service basically say, Nate trusted God with his life. Will you? And then we sang Our God Reigns or God, You Reign. And it was this sweet moment where kids finally got to see what God was up to and, you know, what God was doing in his life. Like I said, when I look back at that day, it was really hard to see what God was up to. But when I look at the scope of Nate's life and the brief part that I got to be a part of, it sort of makes sense. I mean, it really does, you know, and that's sort of where we're at today in Genesis. Today in Genesis, we're looking at one chapter. And this is true anywhere in the Bible. If you just sort of read the Bible by opening up, reading a chapter, and then closing it, expecting to get a holistic view of who God is, it's not going to happen. And just like in our life, right? A lot of times we'll look at our life and we'll say, God, why are you allowing this to happen? Right? Why is this moment happening in my life? Where is it leading to? How can I get out of it, right? But when we read the holistic view of the Bible, when we start to see who God is and what his plan is, then things start to make sense a little bit more. And I see it basically as two ways that God moves, in the macro and in the micro. Anybody take economics in high or college? Right? You remember this? No, no one raised their hand. Okay, we do not have academic people. The macro view is the big view, right? It's when you look at the holistic, the whole scope, right? Everything, how it fits together. The micro view is just a real zoomed in look, right? If you're a photographer, you have two different kinds of lenses, right? The wide angle, it's distorted, but you can see everything. And then you have the zoom lens, right? That you can just see a little bit. Right? In the same way, God moves in that way. There's always the macro plan of God and the micro plan of God. And I think in our lives, we tend to base who God is and base our lives more off of the macro things, am I right? Than the micro things, than the macro things. Okay, watch me. Don't listen to the words I say. One of the things that we like to say here is that God is more interested in our long-term joy than our short-term happiness. And he has to be, right? If God is who he is, and that's why we're reading Genesis, because Genesis talks about this view of God being the creator, the sustainer, the intender of the universe, that he creates and then he has a plan for everything, and no matter what happens, that's what we see through Genesis so far, right? I mean, if you've been here through this series, Genesis, the first book of the Bible, I mean, some humans do some messed up things, right? And they're all over the place. And we got a character over here, and then a character over here. And yet, what do we see God doing through the whole thing? Leading, guiding. We call this God's sovereignty. Some people call it God's providence. But the idea that God works through all situations, no matter what is happening, for the ultimate good of humanity and humankind. Right? And that's what we're going to do today. We are going to jump into the holistic view of God seen in the micro level, right? So that we can sort of understand and comprehend what God's doing in our lives, through our circumstances, through our messes, through our frustrations, and maybe even through the good things going on. Let's see. Now, where am I? Let's go into Genesis, or into Joseph. So the first 36 chapters of Genesis has been focused on 1,000 years of human life, okay? We have these guys that are living forever, and, right? I mean, they're literally living a long, long, long time. What's the longest guy? He lived for 900 and something years. And Methuselah? Okay. And so, anyway, now we get into Joseph's life. Here's what's going to happen. We spent 36 chapter on a bunch of guys. Now we're going to spend 14 chapters to close out our time in Genesis on one guy. That one guy is Joseph. Joseph is the great-grandson of Abraham. He's the grandson of Isaac, and he's the son of Jacob, who got renamed Israel. All right, and he had 12 or 11 brothers, and he was born second to last. Okay, and his dad had four wives, right, and it's almost like he didn't like the other wives, but he had to get through the wives to get to the final wife. I mean, that's kind of what you see. And Joseph is born from that final wife, okay? So his mom was Jacob, his dad's prized wife, okay? And so because of that, Jacob he's liked very much. But even though he's liked, even though he's born into a family where his dad thinks he's great and favors him, even in a sinful way, Joseph's life is a mess, right? I mean, it's almost as bad as Job's, and I'm not joking. And yet there's a difference between between Joseph and a lot of the other Bible characters. We see in Joseph's life that no matter what, he trusted God. I mean, it was crazy. Let me give you a brief snippet of Joseph's life. He's born, he's favored. So what does his brothers feel about him? They hate him. Here's how much his dad favors him. He makes him this fancy coat and says, "You're my favorite one. Here, wear this coat that proves that you're my favorite one." And so his brothers hated him. They were jealous of him. And finally, they try to kill him. But then at the last moment, they don't kill him because they decide they can make some money by selling him to Egyptian slaves, right? And so they sell him. He goes and becomes a slave. So he's prized child to slave, right? This is not a good move in life, right? He's not advancing up the ranks, right? And so he goes and he's a slave. And then the person whom he's a slave to, his wife falls in love with him. And he says, "No, I'm not into that." And so she accuses him and he goes to jail for 12 years, right? So now he's in jail. Okay, so he, prized son, slave, in jail, right? It can't get much better. But God's providence proves true. And he ends up, through some miraculous circumstances that you're going to have to come the next weeks for, he becomes second in charge of all of his Egypt, right? I mean, from slave to in jail to now he's second in charge right behind Pharaoh, because he tells Pharaoh, rightly so, because he was really connected to God, that there's going to be this massive famine. And so they needed to plan well. And it was true. And so this famine comes, and all the countries around Egypt don't have any money. I mean, they're starving. They have nothing to live on. And so they come groveling to Egypt, saying, "Please, can you help us?" Because Egypt was smart, because Joseph was connected to God. And so anyway, the long and short of it is, check this out, his brothers finally come back to him, begging to have food from their brother that they had tried to kill, right? I mean, this is crazy. And they didn't recognize him. They thought he was dead. They had no idea how life's circumstance, how life's providence was going to happen, right? And if I could just put another plug for our lives, we have no idea what's going on and what God's doing in our lives, right? When we look at the moment by moment, it can seem frustrating, right? We can want an out. We can want to do things to try to control it, to get out of the situation we're in. We see Joseph as a guy that trusted God, that believed that God was going to do what he said he was going to do. And ultimately, we see him in this position, this moment, where he's with his brothers, and he decides their fate. His whole family, he decides their fate. I know how I'd deal with it. How do you think you'd deal with it? I mean, seriously. Here's what Joseph says to his brothers. This is Genesis 50, verse 20. By the way, the title of this sermon is Beginning with the End in Mind. Because if we understand the end of Joseph's life, we'll understand why he lived, what he did. Same thing, if we understand the big picture of who God is, we will better be able to live in trust while we follow God. This is what he says, Genesis 50, 20. "As for you, you meant evil against me, but God meant it for good, to bring it about that many people should be kept alive as they are today." That's crazy, right? He trusted God so much that when push came to shove, and he had his brothers begging him, now the one that they tried to kill, they're begging him, like this is ultimate payback time, and he says, "God, put me here so that I could bless you and love you." And he weeps with his brothers, he embraces them, he basically brings them in as kings. Right? Joseph is an incredible figure. Here's what my ESV study Bible says about Joseph. This principle that God ultimately overrules human sin for his glory and the ultimate good of mankind is important in Scripture. Now, this is one of the defining views of Scripture, that as we look at Scripture, what God is doing through the holistic view of the Bible is that he is in control and we can trust him, right? The problem is, it's really hard to trust him, right? And so here's our main point today. If we can force ourselves to see God's macro plan, then trust will follow in the micro. All right? That's it. Like, if you get that, you're good. We accomplished what we needed to today. And let me just say this before we jump into the text. As we enter Joseph's story, now we've got 14 weeks to spend on Joseph's story, I just want to ask you to join on this journey with me of really evaluating your life for trust. Or maybe you're a believer, you've come here and you follow God and you've sort of been doing this for a while. This will be a great exercise for you. Ask yourself and look at your life and say, how much do I trust and believe in God's ultimate plan? How much do I believe and trust and surrender and submit my life in such a way that God's ultimate plan, right, his long-term joy for me, that I trust it and believe it so that I'm willing to follow him, right? And then maybe some of you come today and you're not really into this whole church and God thing, or maybe you're coming because you were drugged, or maybe you're on the fence, you're just trying to learn. I also would welcome you to ask this question: what are you trusting long-term in your life? You know, are you hoping for a lot of short-term, happy experiences to be enough to sort of get you where you want to go? Or is there something bigger that you can look to and always point to in your life that says, yeah, no matter what I'm going through right now, there is a bigger plan and a bigger purpose and a bigger someone that I'm trusting with my life? And I would just encourage us, because this is the journey Vanessa and I have been on in church planning, and that I think if we all do this, and if for 14 weeks we just submit our lives to trusting and believing that God is going to be who he says he is, I think God's going to do incredible things through us. I think we're going to start boldly, radically, joyfully living and walking out who God has for us to be. And I think that would be an awesome thing for us. So let's jump into Genesis 37. Like I said, we're just taking a momentary look now. And you kind of see the big picture. Let's see what happens on the little picture, okay? And there's two characters I want you to look at while we read this. We're going to see the dad, we're going to see the brothers, and we're going to see Joseph. But there's one brother I want you to look at. His name's Judah. He is the heir later. So if you look at Matthew 1, I think it is, that talks about the bloodline of Jesus, Judah is in the bloodline, okay? He's the guy that Jesus' line comes through, okay? So I want you to look at him, and then I want you to look at Joseph. So here we go. Genesis 37. Jacob lived in the land of his father's sojournings, in the land of Canaan. All right, so Jacob now has settled with his kids in the land of Canaan. And it says, these are the generations of Jacob. So we have just ended a chapter or a section in Genesis. And now it says, now we're going to look at the story of Jacob. And that's where we go forward. Joseph, being 17 years old, was pasturing a flock with his brothers. He was a boy with the sons of Bilhah and Zilpah, his father's wives. Right? I said his father had four wives. And these were two of his father's wives. And Joseph brought a bad report of them to his father. Okay, reason number one, they don't like him. Now Israel loved Joseph more than any of the other sons, because he was the son of his old age. He made him a robe of many colors. And when his brothers saw that their father loved him more than all his brothers, they hated him and could not speak peacefully with them. You ever seen brothers hate each other? Let me tell you this. If you have kids and you favor one of them, the Bible calls it a sin, right? Because what you're doing is you are putting enmity between your brothers. The reason they fought was not because they just didn't like each other or they had squabbles or they were boys. I mean, part of that is created. But the reason they fought is because their father favored Joseph, right? Favoritism is not good. Basically, when you favor a child, you're telling the other children that you don't believe in them as much as you love as this other child of yours. It's bad for both parties, right? It's not good for the one that's being favored, because then everybody hates them, and it's not good for the ones that are not favored, okay? And so this is what Jacob did, though. Now Joseph had a dream, and when he told it to his brothers, they hated him even more. He said to them, "Hear this dream that I have dreamed. Behold, we were binding sheaves in the field, and behold, my sheaf arose and stood upright, and behold, your sheaves gathered around it and bowed down to my sheaf." His brothers said to him, Are you indeed to reign over us? Or are you indeed to rule over us? And so they hated him even more for his dreams.